Hey there, lads and ladies, it is Petrifying Pumpkins here, and I am back with another edition of PSVR News. We've got a few things to talk about today, so without further ado, let's just jump right in. Starting with news of the PlayStation 5 adapter that we're going to need for the PSVR if we want to get that to work on the PS5. There is some news about that. So this news comes courtesy of UploadVR.com and is written by Jamie Feltham. And the title basically gives it away. So the PSVR PS5 camera adapter is included in a new hardware bundles, but only in Japan. You know, in Japan. This is the first time we've actually seen these adapters. They're actually purchasable now by consumers. Now, of course, if you already own the PSVR, Sony have told us you will not need to buy the adapter, but they have not told us how we'll get our hands on it. Do we have to go online, fill in some details, get it sent out to the house? That seems to be the kind of way they're going for now, especially, you know, coronavirus and all this kind of crack. Places like Ireland has just gone into its second lockdown now for the next 6 weeks. So that means I wouldn't be able to go to GameStop to pick one up there, even if they were available for sale right there. So I would imagine they're going to be sending them out to people's homes, I hope. Anyway, so Sony's been pretty quiet about how it will distribute the PSVR PS5 camera adapter needed to use the headset with the new console when it launches in November. Later this month, okay, so it's not out right now, so later in October, you'll be able to pick up one with the headset itself, but in Japan only. And this comes from the Japanese PlayStation blog, where they introduced two new bundles for the company's popular headsets. One includes a pair of Move controllers and four games, which are Astrobot, Everybody's Golf, Blood and Truth, and PlayStation VR Worlds. The second pack includes just the headset and the PSVR Worlds. So in the blog post, they confirm that both of those bundles will include the adapter to plug the PS4 camera into the PS5. They go on sale on October 29th, which is just a few weeks before the PS5's November launch. So keep in mind, in Japan, it's 12th November over there too that it's launching. Not only that, but anyone buying a PSVR separately from the bundle packs will also be given the adapter for free in store at the time of purchase. So it's not just these bundles. Anyone buying a headset from now, well, from the 29th of October on, I guess, is going to be given one of these adapters in store. Now, will it be in the packaging, or is it just going to be something that, like, the cashier is going to be like, oh, here, take this, you know, this separate little thing? I don't know. Sony still hasn't detailed a strategy for getting the camera adapter out to PS5 owners in the West, but has assured it will be distributed free of charge. Sony's new camera that's native to the upcoming console won't support PSVR, and that is indeed strange, I don't know why that is. With PS5 now gearing up for launch on November 12th, we're getting a little anxious to hear exactly how that adapter will be distributed, and that's the end of the post. But I echo that sentiment at the end about getting a little bit anxious to hear, you know, because for me it's a month away. For most of you watching, it's probably less than that, probably only 3 weeks away before the PS5 comes out, for those of you lucky enough to get the pre-order at least. And I know many of you watching probably want to be able to test out PSVR on the PS5 day one, straight away, see what improvements we get in, like, firewall. Is that going to improve frame rates or make the loading times quicker, or, you know, super hot Beat Saber, Resident Evil 7 as well, that would be amazing to check out. All those great games that we love on PSVR, we really want to get them up and running on the PS5 ASAP. We need this adapter. Sony need to say something soon about how we're going to get them. It would be a little bit shit if we have to wait, like, even a week after the PS5 launch. I know it's not much, but what if it runs into multiple weeks, months? You know, we haven't heard anything from Sony. The longer they stay silent, the more kind of anxious we're going to be about it. So with that out of the way, let's talk a little bit about The Walking Dead Onslaught, which yesterday received a huge update. Now, I'm not talking about huge in terms of size, I don't know what the actual size is, but huge in terms of what it does for the game. So many of you may know this already, but Servius made their Walking Dead game, this one called Onslaught. It was originally supposed to have multiplayer and co-op, but that had to get cut, so it was just basically a single player campaign experience, and it had, like, replayability with these scavenger missions, but it was pretty much universally panned, I want to say. Not awful, it scored like 5s, 6s in around that area, and a huge reason for that is because of the combat in the game. Now, that's not the only reason, but that's probably the biggest complaint I saw, is just how simple the combat was. All you needed was a knife that you got at the very beginning, and then you could just breeze through the game. You didn't have to worry about it. And I think the long range weapons were pretty useless because you only needed a knife and that was it. So now they've come along, Servius, with this rebalancing patch, which is now live on all platforms. And they made this post detailing what it what exactly the change with this patch. So I'm just going to go bit by bit through it in terms of the big ones anyway. So point number one, significant ranged combat overhaul. So basically, ranged weapons have got a huge buff now. Before, if you shot a zombie in the head with a gun, it wasn't going to kill us, which is kind of stupid because all you need to do is brain them. Like, that's how they do it in the show anyway. And they die immediately. So here we see all ranged weapons have been tuned to allow for one-hit kills to the brain at close range. Less damage is dealt to the jaw and significantly less damage is dealt to the neck and everything below the neck. Ranged weapons now have custom fall-off damage over distance. Okay, so we're going to... I don't want to go into the granular detail, but basically what you need to know is that the ranged weapons have been buffed. Much more viable now, although some things have been nerfed a little bit in terms of like ammo pickups. So they now grant less ammunition per weapon, increasing the scarcity of ammo. So it's going to be like, going to be more of like, oh wow, cool, we got some weapons, you know, got some bullets. Because these things should be rare in a zombie apocalypse. You shouldn't be, you know, a walking armory, basically. And they also buffed, basically, pistol weapons. So any melee damage you do with a ranged weapon, so if a zombie gets close, you've got a gun and you butt them back, that's going to increase the damage on that, maybe encourage you to use your ranged weapons more. Then point number two then is significant melee weapon combat overhaul. So when the ranged combats got a buff, basically the melee weapons, short range, close combat, got nerfed. So as you can see, less damage is dealt to the jaw and significantly less damage is dealt to the neck and below. And sharp melee weapons, you know, they now get stuck inside zombies after you kill them. So it's no longer just easy to just pop it out, stab another one, pop it out, stab another one. Now you have to free the weapon from the zombie's head. So that's going to make it more time consuming and it's going to make you kind of maybe more cautious about, you know, there's a horde of zombies here, I better not just go stabbing them in the heads because they'll turn around, they'll grab me and bite me, whatever. So as you can see here, dead walkers no longer automatically detach from sharp weapons when impaled. So even when they're dead, you're going to have to work to get the weapon out. And while your weapon is impaled in a walker, your player movement is restricted for as long as the weapon remains stuck in the walker. That makes a lot of sense. As long as you're holding the weapon, it should slow you down until you free it. So that's another nerf. It's kind of nerfing the player movement a little bit when you're attacking melee. So additional simulated ways has been added to heavier / longer melee weapons. So that's going to make them a little bit harder to use. Another nerf. So basically the big takeaway here, this addresses the two biggest complaints, is that the ranged weapons were trash. The melee weapons were OP. So we'll have to wait and see, is that going to be what was needed, you know? Is it enough? Are these enough buffs? Are these enough nerfs? Now, of course, another complaint was about the actual NPCs, the AI, the enemy AI in the game themselves. So that's why point number three talks about the walkers, their aggression and their difficulty. So walker perception and aggression has been increased. So now they're going to see you easier and they're going to be more aggressive. Walkers now deal significantly more damage when biting. Just with those two points right there, they're way more dangerous than they were at launch. So increasing the number of walkers in certain chapters, armored walkers and spiked walkers are now more difficult to kill. So another buff. Spike walkers are now noticeably more deadly than the other walkers. Another buff. So buff, 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 buff. Point number four is some progression, which apparently has been eased. So more food in the early game to allow for smoother level progression. This isn't something I really notice people complaining about, but you know, if it works, it works, it's fine. And then we got some additional changes. This is for some like left-handed people who appreciate this kind of stuff. Reversing the grip. So these are just kind of like little bugs and stuff that they're fixing, or maybe quality of life improvements. So I was someone who was kind of put off from this game by the initial reviews. I was actually really looking forward to it. Then the reviews came out and said, hey, this game is actually kind of trash. Maybe hold off on it until an update comes along. Some people said even with an update, they can't fix this game with an update. But this update looks pretty big, looks pretty comprehensive. I'm going to wait and see what people are saying about this update. Has this fixed the biggest issues? But if it has, I'm going to look into buying this game again. But I am significantly more interested in this game now because of this patch. And hats off to Servios for, you know, listening to the fans, to the players, reviewers. And such a quick turnaround. This game only came out a few weeks ago. And this is a pretty big patch to have out in like, what, 3-4 weeks? I can't remember exactly. So fingers crossed, this has done enough to win people over. So the last thing I want to talk about then isn't news. So maybe it shouldn't belong in this video. But it's just something I wanted to touch on. Something I wanted to maybe raise awareness about in the PSVR community a little bit. This game here, Phasmophobia. There's a good chance you've heard of it by now. Because this game is kind of like Among Us and Fall Guys. Came out of nowhere. from a very, very, very small development studio. I think this could be just one dude. I'm not 100% on that, but it's like really small. Created this game on PC. So this is on Steam. This is on PC VR headsets right now. I've been like addicted to just watching streams and like YouTube videos of people playing this game. I really, really, really want to see it on PSVR. I'm hoping that is something that will happen. Basically, it is a ghost hunting game. You have like these set amount of areas in the game. There's like two different types of houses. There's a haunted high school, there's a haunted asylum. I think there could be a few other areas. You go in there either by yourself or with three other friends, so four player co-op is possible. And you have to go in here into these areas and identify what type of spirit is haunting the area. There's like 10 different types of spirits, and they might have different personalities. So it could be shy, they could be aggressive. There is voice recognition, so you might say the spirit's name to anger them, and you got like a spirit box. It's like a walkie-talkie or a radio that lets you communicate with the dead, so you can say like, where are you? And maybe a creepy voice might come in and say, I'm in the garage or something like that. So why am I talking about this if it's not even a PSVR game? Because I want it to be a PSVR game, and I'm hoping more people maybe reach out to these developers on Twitter or you know, whatever their social channels they're on, and maybe say, hey, how about a PSVR port? That's kind of like what I've been doing on Twitter for the last week or so. And maybe if we make enough noise, they might do something about that. So I've kind of tracked them down. I found their Discord. Their Discord led me to an FAQ. The FAQ led me to this. This is their Trello. So I don't know if anyone knows what a Trello is. This is basically what the developers have as a checklist. So as you can see, they got like a backlog. They got to do, ideas needed, known bugs, in progress, needs testing. And then on the very right is stuff that they've done. So if you look over at the very left, their backlog, you might see this one here. So port to Oculus SDK, publish game on Oculus Store. So what we want to see is port to PSVR, publish the game on PlayStation Store. Now I've gone through all of these backlogs, to-dos, there's no mention of PSVR anywhere. I've reached out on Twitter, like, well, not reached out, but you know, I've commented on Twitter, they've never replied to anything I've said on Twitter, so they don't say, as far as I know, they haven't mentioned PlayStation or porting it to PlayStation or consoles at all. But hopefully that is something that will happen, because this game looks like so much fun. It'd be a great game to stream. There's so much replayability in it, because you know, it could be any of these ghosts. There could be any kind of, like, there's so much permutations that can happen that you could just play this game over and over and over again, kind of like a Firewall or a Star Wars Squadrons kind of thing. There's level progression, you've got unlocks. It's all in-game stuff. You don't have to worry about, you know, DLCs and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, I'll put a link to the Twitter page of the developers in the description. So if you're on Twitter, maybe give them a follow. If you see them posting anything, maybe say, hey, how about a PSVR port? You know, maybe just let them know there's money to be made over here, you know? And because this game is getting so popular now, I mean, you see PewDiePie is playing as, you know, Jacksepticeye. So that's going to get lots of eyes on that game. The more popular it gets, the increased chance there is of some bigger fish to swoop in, make a clone, basically. I mean, look what Fortnite did to PUBG. Everyone on console, hey, PUBG, please come to console. Please, please, please. They said, no, we're focused on PC first. Epic come along and say, hey, we'll just add this to our Fortnite game. We'll have it as a separate mode, and we'll release it on all the platforms simultaneously. And now Fortnite dominates the mindshare when it comes to Battle Royale. And of course, there's been countless clones, you know, Call of Duty, Warzone, Apex Legends, all that kind of stuff too. But I'd really like to get this on PSVR, because this developer in particular is happy to support VR over on PC. So, you know, I wouldn't be so confident about like a copycat supporting VR on the console side of things. So yeah, that's me raising awareness for Phasmophobia. Not that it needs like, well, I should say raising awareness for the PSVR cause of Phasmophobia. You know, because obviously Phasmophobia is doing a good enough job raising awareness just by itself. You know, all these streamers and stuff. It's going to be huge. This game is going to be huge. It's already getting pretty huge right now, but I think it's going to be up at like Among Us, Fall Guys, that kind of level. Anyway, that is it for this episode of PSVR News. Before I go, let me give a huge thank you to my Patreon supporters whose names are on the screen as I speak. Thanks to their generosity, they're helping keeping this channel going. In particular, let me give a shout out to the following top tier Patreon supporters: Tradition, Pete Hawkins, Chopped517, Crumb, and Daniel the Pumpkin Patch Kid. Thank you very much for that incredible generosity. I really do appreciate it. If you'd like to help us over on Patreon, check out patreon.com/petrifyingpumpkins. The link to that will be in the description. But if not, I'll be happy with just the likes, comments, shares, all that usual YouTube shite. Finally, before I go, let me thank Decepticon for letting me use his music in all my videos. So check him out over on Decepticon.com, and you'll find him on Spotify, all that kind of stuff. The link to him will be in the description below. And with that, I will end this video. Thank you very much for watching, lads and ladies. Stay moist.